Blackstone Publishing presents Buckskin, Bloomers, and Me by Johnny D. Boggs. This book is read by Alex Boyles. For the last Dallas Times-Herald, People's Revolutionary Softball Team, 1991. Chapter 1. The Blues lost the opening and closing games of the season, to say nothing of the 97 other games which they neglected to win. St. Paul took the first, and the rival town of Minneapolis took the last. Probably the most wretched season in baseball in Kansas City came to an inglorious close at 4:40 o'clock yesterday afternoon, when a miller brought in the winning run on a passed ball that did not roll 15 feet from the plate. The Kansas City Journal, Kansas City, Missouri, September 20th, 1897. He rode into my life on a real fine train just this past summer. Call me Buckskin, he said, but I'll get to him directly. First, I want to tell how come Buckskin, and a lot of other folks, and me met, including the wretched woman who put me through this ordeal. Any of you who has had the misfortune to meet the widow Amy DeFee in person knows I ain't stretching the truth at all when I call her the vilest, repulsivest, meanest, contemptiblest, and poorest excuse for a woman ever to set foot in Kansas, Missouri, and Colorado. And whilst she can handle a 30-30 Winchester better than Annie Oakley, and knows more than most folks about the game of baseball, admittedly, she sure learnt me enough, nobody ever educated her that kidnapping, theft, graft, crooked gambling, horse theft, and especially murder is criminal, and she plumb forgot all them rules of good sportsmanship, honesty, and the fact that it ain't winning that matters most, it's the way you play the game, which is how good folks, good ballists, and us Westerners keep our heads held high, 'cause we play and live the right way. And we don't kill nobody neither, in blood colder than a hibernating rattlesnake. But, well, there just ain't no other way to put it but true. The widow Amy DeFee ain't got nothing in her black heart and blackest of souls but wickedness. Which is a terrible sentiment to say about your ma. Course, she ain't really my ma, not my birthing ma, I mean. Before I knew the difference between a shine ball and an emery ball, my real ma, Gertrude Grace, died of consumption or cholera or colic or ringworm, depending on how much John Barleycorn pa had consumed and just who he happened to be relaying the story to on how he become a widower. That's when Pa took to drink worser than he had back when Ma was living. There wasn't no kin left on either side of the family. We wasn't steady churchgoers even when Ma was alive, and Ma took care of all my schooling, which weren't much except for them McGuffies, so it didn't take long before Pa learnt that he needed someone to care for me, else he'd never find time to get roostered while rolling dice down back of the depot. Therefore, some months after Ma got called to glory, Pa come across this advertisement in the Romeo and Juliet Marriage Plan Company yearbook. White American widow, age 29, weight 105, height 5 feet 4 inches, hazel eyes, brown hair, Baptist, income $700 per annum, good cook, neat, clean, tidy. Will marry if suited. I read it to Pa, getting plenty of help from the conductor on the Frisco line with them tougher words. Actually, I had to read all 29 other advertisements, but that's the one that struck Pa's fancy. Maybe on account of that $700 figure, but most likely because it was the last one I read before Pa got tired of hearing them words good housekeeper and no flirts will receive attention and anxious to meet Western men and will answer all correspondence as long as postage is provided. Too bad Pa never took in one of them shows put on by theatrical troops when they stopped at the Pleasanton Opera House. Had he seen Romeo and Juliet, which I took in a month ago last Thursday, Pa maybe could have figured out that this romance wasn't going to have no happy ending. But what with the Romeo and Juliet Marriage Plan Company being based in Kansas City, Missouri, and us living in Pleasanton and right on the Frisco line, Pa gathered me up and we hopped a freight to Kansas City. We had to do this since Pa, though being employed most of the time by that particular railroad, didn't have no railroad pass and wasn't willing to pay that discount.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.